and refund. Henry Ford was born on a farm. He grew up more than 100 years ago in Michigan. He had 5 younger brothers and sister, and they all had to work hard for their father. Much too hard, Henry thought. We wish they had more machines to help them in the fields. Henry loved to play around with machines. His brothers and sisters got wheel up toys for Christmas. They had to hide them because Henry always took them apart to see how they work. He's a tinkerer, not a farmer, his father used to say. He was right. When Henry was 16, he walked to the nearby city of Detroit, and for the next 3 years, he did odd jobs there, working with machines. Then he went back home, but his head was still full of machines. There was one machine in particular that he could not stop thinking about: the motor car. Hundreds of years ago, there were hardly any cars on the roads. In many parts of the world, there were very few railroads at all. If you want to get around, you had to use horses, boats, baggies, or steam trains. But all these methods cost money. Ordinarily, working people could hardly ever afford to use them. As a result, they rarely traveled very far. When he was in Detroit, Henry heard that the first motor cars were being made in Europe, light day cars. They used gasoline to make their engine go. People were amazed by them, but thought they were very dangerous. In Britain, someone had to walk in front of a slowly moving car, waving a red flag as a warning. This first car was so expensive that people called them rich man toys. But why? Henry wondered. Should the rich have only one? Surely everybody should have one. For several years, Henry went on farming and tinkering. He planned one day to make cars or horse-like carriage of his own. In the meantime, among other experiments, he built his own steam-powered tractor. Henry did not work on the town. When he was 25, he married Clara Bryan, who had grown up on a nearby farm. She thought Henry was such a genius, but with the machine that he was about to succeed in the end. But he needed more money for his experiments. So he took a job in Detroit as chief engineer at the electric power plant. Henry and Clara bought a house in the city. Soon they had a son. They named him Edsel, after Henry's oldest friend. Henry worked hard at the power plant, but he worked even harder in his own backyard workshop, hammering together spare pieces of metal until at last his first gasoline driven car was ready for a test run. Was almost 2 o'clock in the morning. Henry and his helper Jim Bishop rolled his strange-looking car toward the workshop doors. Henry later called it his baby carriage because that is what it looked like. But there was a problem. He had made it too big to get through the doorway. So he simply snatched up a hammer and smashed a bigger hole in the brick wall. Then, with Clara watching, he started the car and drove off over the cobbled nighttime street. Jim Bishop rode ahead on a bicycle to make sure that no one got in the way. The car worked perfectly. The next day, Henry took Clara and Adele for their first bumpy ride. Henry's friends called him Crazy Henry because he was so mad about cars. When he was 36, he gave up his job and began to make and sell cars full time. He built one car especially for racing, the 999. Then the 999 was ready. Henry wanted to test it right away in a race against Alexander Winton's new car, but Clara stepped in. She was too scared to let Henry drive the racer. So Bernard Oldfield, a bicycle rider, said he would do it. These were very brave. He had to learn to drive in only a week. The day of the race came. Bunny took an early lead and never let the other driver catch up. The noisy car rolled around the 5 miles across yet 8 kilometer course, and Bunny finished in 5 minutes, 28 seconds, an American record. People now saw that Henry was not crazy at all. Soon, rich businessmen were helping him to set up the Ford Motor Company. In its first 5 years, the company produced 8 different types or models of a car. Each was named after a letter of the alphabet. The one that made Henry Ford's fortune was Model T. Henry wanted to build a model car for the ordinary people. It would be large enough for the family, but small enough for one person to run and care for, he said in 1950. Gerald. 7. It will be made of the best materials by the best worker and in the simplest way possible. But it will be so low in price that any man who earned a good wage will be able to own one. In 1908, his Model T car went on sale, costing $825 each. They were a terrific value for the money. They sold very quickly and they kept on selling. The Model T was truly the people car, and the people loved it. They even gave it a nickname, the Tin Lizzy. The first motor company made Tin Lizzy for 19 years. It sold 15.5 million of them in the United States, 1 million in Canada, and another 250,000 in Britain. But it had taken 100 years to make his first car. How could he now make so many Model T? First, teams of workers build the Model T's one by one. Thousands of customers were waiting. So the company opened a big new factory or plant at Highland Park in Michigan. But still it took the team too long to make each car. Henry and his colleagues knew that the system of building had to be changed. So they set up assembly line. They were constantly moving belt carrying section of cars, which the workers stood next to. And when, for example, the car's engineer slowly passed by, the worker would fit piston or crankshaft to them. Each man had just one simple job to do. The man who places a patch does not button it, said to Henry. The man who puts in a bolt does not put on the nut. The man who puts on the nut does not tighten it. Cars could be made much faster this way, and then be sold even more cheaply. But for the workers, this new way of car making could be terribly boring. Henry hit on a good plan to stop his worker on the assembly line from feeling bored. He doubled their wage from $2.50 to $5 a day. That same week, thousands of other men hurried to Highland Park to ask for jobs. A riot broke down, and the police had to shock everyone with fire hose to stop. Henry chose his worker carefully. He paid them good wage, but they had to lead good, clean lives, both in the plant and at home. A special department was set up to make sure no one was misbehaving. Henry kept a close eye on the plant's top manager too. The Ford Motor Company was like one big family, with Henry as its father. Some men found him much too bossy, so they left to take other jobs. But one man never had the chance to leave. These were Henry Winline's son, Alistair. Henry was always very fond of Alistair. He taught the boy to drive when he was just 8. In those days, there was no law against children driving, so Henry also gave him a car to drive himself to school and back. When Alistair reached the age of 21, Henry took him to a bank in Detroit, showed him $1 million in gold, then gave it to him as a birthday present. Alistair never did any job except work for his father. Sometimes that were hard. Henry rarely treated him like a grown-up, but he had everything else that he wanted. His father was, after all, once a world's richest and most famous man. For a while, Henry even had to wear a false beard because he was so tired of people recognizing him and stopping him in the street. Like Clara in the early days, many people thought he was a genius. They thought he could do absolutely anything. Unfortunately, so did Henry now. In 1914, the First World War broken out in Europe. Henry was disgusted. He thought ordinary people should be working and buying cars, not killing one another. So, with some friends, he decided he would end the war. His plan was to go to Europe and keep talking to both sides until they agreed to stop fighting. Thousands of people came to watch his ocean liner set sail from New York. Some of them thought Henry really had gone crazy this time. One man sent him to squirrel in a cage. He wrote that they were to go with the nut on board the liner. When the peace ship arrived in Norway, the newspaper reporter thought he was foolish too. Soon Henry realized that he could not tell a whole continent what to do. Quietly, he sailed home, where many people were still laughing at him. He had failed to make peace. Now he went back to what he did best, making cars. The car plant at Highland Park was here, but Henry had an even grander dream. And finally, after years of hard work, he made his dream come true. In 1927, he completed a new super plant on the banks of the nearby Broad River. It was the most gigantic assembly line ever seen. At one end, all the raw material poured in: iron ore, coal, timber, limestone, silicon, for glass. After just 28 hours, finished car poor out at the other end. There were more than 90 different buildings for 42,000 workers, 5,000 men with mops and buckets, did nothing all day long except keep the place clean. Here the company built a new type of cars, first the Model A, then the V8. Henry still made only good cheap cars, and his company was now busy in 33 different countries in his homeland. People told each other stories about him as if he were a fairy tale hero. As Henry grew rich and famous, he met friends with other rich and famous people. These were men like Thomas Edison, the inventor of electric light, Harvey Harvey Firestone, the rubber tie maker, and John Burroughs, a brilliant scientist. Every summer, the four of them went on camping trips together. One year, they stopped at a service station while the attendant replaced a broken car headlight. Henry said to him, "The man who invented this light is over there." "Thomas Edison," gasped the attendant. "Yes," said Henry, "and I am Henry Ford, and that man next to him is Harvey Firestone, who makes this tie." Suddenly, the attendant grew suspicious. He could not believe that so many well-known men were traveling together. Then he saw John Burroughs with his long white beard. "Look here, mister," he said to Henry. "If you are going to tell me that other guy is Santa Claus, I'm going to call the sheriff." Then the Model T went on sale in 1908. Henry Ford was 45 years old. As he got older, he found it harder to run the business. Times were tough all over the world in the 1930s. Henry could no longer afford to pay his workers so well. The Ford Motor Company was still a big family, but it was not a happy one. Other companies were now building more luxurious and more modern cars. Edison wanted Henry to do the same, but Henry was stubborn. He had always liked everything to be plain and simple. The customer can have the Model T painted any color he wants, he once said, so long as it is black. By the 1940s, the company was in quite a mess. It was real sick with worry, and at the age of 49, he died. Elder son Henry Ford II took over his father's job. One day he would make the company great again, but before then, old Henry himself died. Henry had never been interested in making money to buy things. His goal, he said, was to make the world a little better. He died in 1947 at 83. tank married to him, car making has become a curious industry in the new United States, but by making cheap cars for ordinary people, Henry Ford had helped to make even greater change. When he left his father's farm as a young man, for American in every fight, live cut off from one another on farm. When Henry died, four in every five lived in city. And all these cities were now linked together by the finest system abroad on earth. People remember that Henry Ford once said that his story is bunk. He also said that the present is far more important than the past. Yes, few people have had a bigger effect on the history of the 20th century than Henry Ford.